Good evening, everyone, and welcome. I'm Lisa DeSisto. I'm the publisher of the Portland Press Herald. And welcome to another edition of Maine Voices Live. A special welcome to all of our home delivery subscribers. Yes, thank you. Give yourself a hand. Thank you. Thank you very much. We have another great event planned for tonight when Lily King will be joining us on the stage, and she's going to be interviewed by Press Herald Features reporter Bob Keyes. So if you've been before and Bob's been in that chair, you know you're in for a treat tonight. As we do at every Maine Voices Live, I would like to thank our sponsors, and I would look at my notes for that. First, I would like to thank New England Cancer Specialists. They're focused on one thing only, and that's the very best outcome for patients with cancer. As the region's leading oncology practice, last year they served more than 3,100 people with many types of cancer and blood disorders, and they have three offices nearby in Scarborough, Kennebunk, and Brunswick. So thank you to New England Cancer Specialists. Thank you. And I would also like to thank our presenting sponsor, HM Pace, and debuting their new sign tonight. Isn't it lovely? So yes, the signage is very impressive, but for more than 160 years, H.M. Payson has been an integral part of the Portland community. H.M. Payson believes strongly that support for the arts and the free exchange of ideas and viewpoints has never been more important, and so true for those of us who watched the debate last night. Sponsorship of forums such as these celebrate and serve the greater Portland community, the state of Maine, and all of its citizens. So thank you to H.M. Payson. And also thank you to the Press Hotel, who provides accommodations for our guests, and also to Hub Furniture, who outfits our set for us each time we are here. So now on to Lily King, one of Maine's best known and most accomplished writers, which is saying something because we all know that Maine is home to some of the most accomplished writers in all of America, many of whom have been on this stage with us. Her most recent novel, Euphoria, won the Kirkus Prize for Fiction, excuse me, and the New England Book Award for Fiction. It was a finalist for the National Book Critics Circle Award, and the New York Times named it one of the top 10 books of 2014. Her previous book, Father of the Rain, released in 2010, won the New England Book Award for Fiction, a Maine Literary Award, and was named a summer must-read by O, the Oprah magazine. Though she spent much of her life in California, Lily is a New Englander. She grew up in Massachusetts and has lived in Maine since 2002, when she moved to Yarmouth with her husband and family. We have so many fantastic writers in Maine, and we're lucky to have hosted several of them here at Maine Voices Live, and tonight we are thrilled to add Lily King to that list. Please welcome to the stage Portland Press Herald features writer Bob Keyes and our special guest tonight, Lily King.
Greetings and welcome again to Maine Voices Live. I say again because I think I recognize many voices here from previous events. I know many of you as returning guests and loyal readers, so thank you very much. And if you're here for the first time, welcome, and thanks for coming out and supporting our series. Maine Voices Live has become a really fun series for us to host, for the newspaper and for reporters as individuals. It gives us an opportunity for in-depth conversations with people in Maine whose voices are filled with reason and respect. It's true, it's absolutely true. We have great conversations on this stage. We want these conversations to be thoughtful, and we want them to present opportunities for substantial back and forth. But perhaps most important, they give us all a chance to pause and listen to each other as friends and as neighbors and as members of our larger community. So thank you all for being here. And Lily, thank you for coming.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yes.
Thank you.
So I want to begin by talking about your life in these last couple of years.
Okay.
I imagine it's been a little bit crazy. In 2014, you published Euphoria, or your publisher published Euphoria. It was your fourth novel. It has done extremely well, obviously. We heard all the awards from Lisa. It won the Kirkus, which came with the $50,000 prize. It was a National Book Critics Circle finalist. It was on all the top 10 lists. So the first question is, what's next? A Pulitzer?
No pressure.
No pressure. No.
You know, I mean, really, honestly, I just kind of like to go, because I think all of that doesn't help the writing one iota.
I'm sure it does not.
I don't know. Well, I hope what's next is another small novel.
How has the success of that book changed your life in tangible ways in terms of either the pressure or the expectation or just how you live your life day to day?
In some ways, not really at all in terms of the writing process and I think, you know, who I really am as a writer. What it did demand of me is a lot more of my time. I mean, usually I would publish a book and they would send me on a book tour it would sort of go for maybe 3 months, but I had small kids for every book. And so they would send me out for a few days and then I would come back, stay home for a couple of weeks, go out for a little bit longer, maybe to the West Coast for 4 days, come back. And this book tour didn't seem to end for about a year and a half to 2 years. there were just more things that were required of me, either by my publisher or I would get these offers where actually people would pay me to speak. And that was really hard to turn down because that had never happened before and it seemed like it would never happen again. And so I should take advantage of it. But at the same time, always trying to, you know, balance my life as a mother.
Yeah. So that's a tangible example of success. You have more demands on your time, less time to write, more challenges as a parent.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you still riding the buzz of euphoria or has it passed?
I feel like it's mostly past. I mean, I think it's mostly past, and I need it to be past. I need to really not think about this book anymore, and try to immerse myself in the next book. And that's been very difficult for a number of reasons. Not just the demands from Euphoria.
Sure.
Okay, sorry, now I'm having a hot flash. I'm so sorry. I love that.
Feel free to drink the water.
I love it when people can relate.
Well, I don't want to get too far ahead and ask about your next book yet, but I will.
Okay.
The problem with Euphoria is that it's going to be hard to escape. There's been a lot of conversations about a movie. You want to tell us what the status of the potential movie is?
So the movie has fortunately not occupied very much of my time. Very early on, even before the book came out, I got an offer. And I thought, and of course my publisher as well was like, wait, we have to wait, you know, we have to wait and see what happens with this book. Don't take the first offer. And then my film agent and my literary agent were like, this is such a good offer. This is such a great director. It was the director, Michael Apted, and his wife, Paige Simpson, was the producer. Sorry, not quite done. And they said, you know, these kinds of novels that are in an exotic place with a very large cast are so hard to make, no one will touch them. And you have to take this offer. And so it was very tough. I was getting a lot of different advice and really had to think about it. So I found out that that was absolutely true. All these books that you would have thought would have been snatched up right away were not being snatched up. And so I went with it. And so I had a director and I had a producer. And it took them a while to, they're so great. They're the nicest, most wonderful people, and I love Michael Apted's work. He did the 7-Up series and Coal Miner's Daughter and Gorillas in the Mist. He's been around for a long time. And they got a screenwriter, David McGee, who did Life of Pi and Finding Neverland, which is really just a beautiful, beautiful movie. And he wrote a screenplay that I loved, which was amazing. And I thought I was going to hate it and pull out my hair and not know what to do. And it was great. And then they got financing. And like it's every, you know, 6 months, there's another step and another step. And so here we are, and 2 years later. And now they say they're going to start filming in January of 2017. But we have no actors, so I'm not exactly sure how that's going to happen.
Do you get involved in the screenplay at all? Do you have approval process? Or?
Well, I don't even think it's written in the contract that I have to. Maybe I have to have some sort of, you know, I can give my feedback or something. But they were so great. They sent it right to me when he had a final draft, and I gave them lots of feedback. But mostly, I just loved it, and a lot of the feedback was, you know, more of you and less of me. He really did stay quite faithful to my dialogue, and anytime he put in his own dialogue, I liked it much better. It was so new and fresh, and I really loved what he did. He had just a wonderful touch with it, and also he took the very last scene of the book and he made it first. And, you know, such a movie thing to do, but it works. It really worked. At first I was like, no, I cannot believe I'm reading this. And then I thought it worked really beautifully. So
that's got to be courageous on your part to sort of step back and let go of it and trust.
I can't write a screenplay. Yeah. I mean, I tried once and a friend of mine who is a screenwriter was like, that is a screenplay written by a novelist. So I can't do that.
I'm assuming most folks here have read the book or know what it's about, but just in case there's some folks who don't, you want to give a quick summary of it and maybe choose a passage to read?
Oh, sure. I got the idea for this book because I stumbled upon a biography of Margaret Mead, and I really never even thought I would read that, but I did, and it was very compelling, and I still just thought I was just enjoying a biography. I was writing Father of the Rain, actually, at the time, and then I got to chapter 11, and it was this five-month period in Margaret Mead's life when she's 31 years old, and it's 1933, the end of 32, 33, and she gets herself in a really intense love triangle with her husband and another anthropologist in the region in Papua New Guinea where they were doing work. And it was such a claustrophobic, fascinating time where they were kind of spiking malarial fevers and having breakthroughs and, you know, fearing for their lives. And I couldn't believe that I didn't know this story, that nobody had written about this story. And I had to find out more. And I really was writing another novel. I was not going to write. That's just not what I do, write a historical novel about Margaret Mead in 1933 in the tropics. It's just, you know. So as I was kind of pursuing this story, I was really telling myself that I was not going to write this. But I started, you know, taking notes, and a whole notebook grew, and I had scenes and dialogue, and, you know, and finally after I finished Father of the Rain, I realized, like, I guess I'm going to write that novel now, but I thought I was crazy to do it. And the whole time I was writing it, I didn't know what I was doing, and I had no confidence in it whatsoever. And my husband, who never, ever, ever tells me to quit, I'm always wanting to quit, and especially when I get about two-thirds of the way through something, and he's like, and he finally said to me, you know, maybe you should quit this book. And I was like, I'm not quitting! But I really thought it was going to be, you know, a book that I was going to finish, and my editor would look at it, and my agent would look at it, and we would all put it in the drawer, and we would move on. So it was a surprise. It was just a surprise that anyone got to the end of this book, to be honest with you. I know I was answering a different question.
No, well, that's a great... I asked about the genesis of it and a brief summary, and that was perfect.
Right. Okay, now I'm supposed to read something.
If you would like to, we would love to hear something.
I think the beginning is always the best place to go in this point. So it just starts when... basically, I fictionalize everything. I mean, I got the idea and I thought that I would write the Margaret Mead story, but as the video said, I got about four pages into it and realized, oh, you know, I can't do that. I can't be chained to these lives and what really happened. And there's very little that's documented about this five-month period, and so I was going to have to make it up anyway. And so when I started making it up, it really did just, you know, there was the fact and there was fiction and just went like that. But here at the beginning is the most like what really happened. You know, they were, although in real life, they went to see Gregory Bateson. But here, these characters, Nell and Fenn, decide to go to see Andrew Bankson is his name in here. But anyway, you're not even, I'll just read you a page, so we won't even get there. As they were leaving the Mombano, someone threw something at them. It bobbed a few yards from the stern of the canoe, a pale brown thing. Another dead baby, Fenn said. He had broken her glasses by then, so she didn't know if he was joking. Ahead lay the bright break in the curve of dark green land where the boat would go. She concentrated on that. She did not turn around again. The few Mombano on the beach were singing and beating the death gong for them, but she did not look at them a last time. Every now and then, when the four rowers, all standing, calling back to their people or out to other canoes, pulled at the same time, a small gust of wind struck her damp skin. Her lesions prickled and tightened as if hurrying to heal in the brief dry air. The wind stopped and started, stopped and started. She could feel the gap between sensation and recognition of it and knew that the fever was coming on again. The rowers ceased rowing to stab a snake-necked turtle and haul it into the boat, still writhing. Behind her, Fenn hummed a dirge for the turtle, too low for anyone but her to hear.
That's beautiful. That's poetic. I'm interested in your writing voice. Do you sense that your writing voice has evolved novel to novel, and can you feel its progress, if you will?
You know, it's such a good question. I do think about that a lot. But I can't help thinking that every novel is just its own little puzzle. And finding the voice, which took me a long time to find the voice for this novel, actually, because I did think it was going to be from her perspective. And then I started writing chapter two, and it was from his perspective, and I felt a power and an energy in his perspective that I did not feel in hers. And so I realized, oh, you know, this is his voice. And so I feel like I kind of grew another appendage as a writer just writing his voice. But I don't feel like it was my voice. I feel much more, you know, I don't really love it when writers get all kind of spiritual and like it was a visitation and I was speaking through them. Or they were speaking through me. I just don't, I don't really feel that way exactly, but it's hard to explain it any other way. Mm-hmm. And so I'm not even sure if I feel that that was my voice. It was just a voice that grew, and I think anytime you're having trouble with a novel or with a piece of writing, often the trouble is the voice. You're not getting that quite right, and so I do feel like I'm still always struggling. And I'm 90 pages into a rough draft of a new novel. I couldn't even tell you anything about that voice right now. You know, it's almost like I write it and I don't even feel that it's a voice. And then I'll put it aside, and you know, it'll be done, the rough draft, and then I'll go back to it, and then I can hear it, and I can enhance it and make it, and I can know what it is. But right now, when it's, you know, being formed, I don't know what it is.
When you sit down to write in the morning or whenever you write, are you able to pick up where you left off the next day, or do you have to be in that state of mind that allows you to go into some other place that allows you to develop that voice or find that
voice?
You mean,
do I wait for the state of mind where I feel like writing like a poet?
Yeah, I guess.
No, I mean, you know, to write novels, I really think you have to get up every morning and get to the page. You know, I mean, I get my kids off and then I actually, you know, I eat my breakfast, I read the paper, and then I sit down. I used to, before I had kids, I would get up at 5:30 and I was much more an early morning writer, but that is gone, and maybe someday it will come back when they go to college. But I know I force myself, and sometimes it doesn't happen, and sometimes it does. But I'm always there waiting for it, and sometimes I'll have to, you know, just end the scene quickly and move on to something else. Or I know that Hemingway said, you know, he said that he would stop in the middle of a sentence so that the next day there would always be something. You know, he would never finish a scene or finish a chapter so that it was complete blankness the next day. But I often, you know, tie things up in some way, or sometimes I don't. It kind of all depends. And then you just kind of have to force yourself to forge on.
Do you blow past your deadlines? And I don't mean like miss deadlines, but do you decide I'm going to write for 3 hours today, but you're on a roll, and then you just keep going and go for 4 or 5 and text your husband and say, pick up the kids?
No. No, my husband's also a writer, and so if I started doing that, he would do that to me, so no. I stick with what we've decided in the morning is what happens, you know? So no one messes anybody up because they're having a creative moment.
Yep.
And, you know, yes, I mean, oftentimes I say I'm going to write for 3 hours and then I'm going to answer emails and I'm going to do it and then I just blow past it all. But often not because I'm like scribbling, writing, you know, like Virginia Woolf writing to the lighthouse or something. It's usually because I have had a really, really crap day and nothing's happened and goddamn it, I'm going to sit here and write for 2 more hours and squeeze something out of the day before I have to go get the kids.
And you do scribble. You write by
I do. Yeah. I have my notebook here.
Yeah. And that's always been your habit.
It is all ever since high school.
Yeah. Have you ever tried writing on a computer to a first draft?
You know, I sometimes write pieces every now and then when I get really frustrated and, you know, I switch pencils, you know, I switch brands of tea, but nothing's working. And so then maybe I'll go to the computer and sometimes the computer, you know, it has its advantages. I know I like that. And I often write short stories on the computer. When I often dabble and I it's not that I completely stay away from it. And I also, you know, obviously type everything up and work very, very, very much on the computer in a creative way. But
so
mostly I do that.
What are you working on now?
I am having a hard time making this book sound appealing. I am working on a story, a novel, I hope, about the time in life when you know, you're either in your early 20s, mid-20s, late-20s, or 30s, whatever, and you... are trying to make your dream happen. You know, you have a passion and you want to make it happen. And pretty much all the forces in your life are telling you that you should go to law school or you should, you know, get a 9-to-5 job. And so I'm definitely drawing on some of my own experiences. I was a waitress until I was 34 years old writing a novel. It's really humiliating to be that much in debt, and I couldn't have my own apartment. I couldn't. I wanted a dog more than anything. I wanted my life to move on, and yet I could not let go of this idea of being a writer. And I haven't read a lot of books about that, and so I'm trying to do it.
It almost sounds like a memoir.
Yeah, no, because there's a lot of really good romances that I completely make up. Well, some of them I make up.
If I recall correctly, I think you have said in the past that the success of Euphoria was a little bit liberating because it allowed you to write from something other than personal experience.
Mm.
You could fill in, go outside the lines and use different colors than you're supposed to. Do you feel that you can take more chances now as a writer because of what you experienced with Euphoria? And might that play out in what you're working on now?
Yeah, it's interesting because I really have always tried to be the kind of writer who really drew from my imagination and did not write. You know, my first novel was not the tell-all autobiographical novel by any means. I mean, I made all of that up. And I mean, I did live in France, and so I drew from those experiences. But I never really wanted to be stuck with just my own little postage stamp because I knew that I was going to run out of material very quickly. And so I would say, you know, Father of the Rain is maybe my most autobiographical novel, although so much of it is fiction. And I think as a reaction to Father of the Rain, for many reasons, I think I was attracted to writing something where nobody at a reading could say to, you know, immediately first question, how much of this is true? How much of this happened to you? I got so tired of that question.
Absolutely.
And this is so great, but now it's all about Margaret Mead. I mean, it's so interesting, you know. They want to know exactly how much of it is about Margaret Mead and how much of it is fiction. So it's the same question, just in a different way.
That's very interesting. Huh.
Yeah, but I did. It did give me a lot of excitement to just look around the world and think, what do I want to write next, you know? And I've had all sorts of ideas and ideas that I wouldn't have had if I hadn't written that book. And that's been really, really exciting.
Because you feel that you have the self-confidence to tell those stories that were foreign to you?
I have the confidence to try.
Yeah.
You know, I'm never convinced I'm going to succeed, but at least I'll think, well, I can give that a try.
Okay. I want to ask about the Maine writing community. Yeah. Much of my job involves writing about the visual arts in Maine. And the concept of Maine arts is so richly defined around the world and instantly recognized. And I think the same is starting to be true of Maine writing. The whole idea of the Maine writing community, I think, is getting known nationally and perhaps even internationally. It seems that we're enjoying this moment of, euphoria. Sorry. You don't write about Maine per se, but you're very much a part of the Maine writing community. What does it mean to you to be part of this community?
Oh, it means everything. I mean, I moved here, I had no idea. I had no idea what I would discover when I moved here from Massachusetts. My kids were really small. We had moved to get out of the city and to, you know, find a good school and live sort of a simpler life, really. I mean, and I brought my writing with me, thinking I would just, you know, write. Maybe I would meet a friend. I didn't even hope to meet another writer. I didn't really even think about it, to be honest with you. I was so focused on my family, and I don't know. I had never really had a writing community before, so it never occurred to me that I would find one. And there it was. I mean, the Maine Writers and Publishers Alliance is such an amazing organization. And Josh Bodwell now runs it and has made it blossom even more. And also, you know, the Telling Room, my friends, Susan Conley and Sarah Corbett and Mike Paterniti, they were some of the... Susan I knew from Boston, and we'd not moved here together, but we'd moved here very closely at the same time, and so happy to have each other here. And then I was introduced to Mike and Sarah really soon after that, and the three of them were introduced together, and they just, boom, started the Telling Room. And I became a volunteer there, and so that the Maine Publishers Writers Alliance and then Telling Room just attracted all of these writers, and you know, so many great events, so many great readings, and so much support, and no competition as far as I can tell. And the fact that Rick Russo shows up at all of these things and supports all of us. I mean, he gave me the most amazing blurb. He didn't know who I was. I mean, I met him one time, and you know, so kindly. You know, I owe so much of that book to just that one blurb by him. I mean, and that's extraordinary. I mean, there's just not a hierarchy, not a. It's just a beautiful, beautiful thing.
Yeah, it really is remarkable. And I think what you said is true in terms of the lack of competition. Everybody wants to see everybody else's book succeed. People show up at the readings. They support each other in real substantial ways. So are you going to write about Maine? Do you have a Maine book in you?
I definitely have a Maine book in me. But it hasn't risen quite yet. But it's there, I'm sure.
Okay. Good. So you're first and foremost a mother. You have two teenage daughters. Obviously, you've talked about your wife. You live in Yarmouth, and you have all the challenges that mothers of teenage daughters face. I want to know how you balance those obligations with being a best-selling writer whose books are being optioned in movies.
Well, that all sounds very nice, but really, it's my whole world revolves around my kids. Mm-hmm. I feel like my writing is like a very small side thing compared to, you know, the the focus and the interest, you know, I have with my kids. But fortunately, they go to school, so I am left to my own devices while they're in school, and that was really a miracle when they did that, because I did really struggle when they were little with wanting just basically to be the perfect mother, which was, you know, a lot of pressure that I put on myself, and obviously have failed to be perfect. But I just really wanted to be there for them. I didn't have that kind of childhood where my parents were there for me. And it was so important to me, so incredibly important to me. And I didn't know what to do about this desire to write because it got in the way. And that was really confusing for me at first, to figure out how I could walk away from my kids, you know, hire a part-time babysitter and write. And that took a while, and actually a therapist to help me through that, to understand that it was okay for me to work 15 hours a week. And I would do the math in the margins of my notebooks. I would write down I would add up all the waking hours of my kids during the week, and then I would, you know, subtract 15, which was my babysitting hours, and it usually came out, I think, to 74 hours. So I was like, okay, 74 hours with them, 15 hours away from them. Was that okay? Was I a good mother in that way? And so it was, you know, and then they went to school. I got to really feed myself in that way and not feel as guilty as I had before.
Do they get what you do now? I mean, they understand who you are out in the bigger world?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, for your kids, you're just who you are. Okay. And let me tell you, it's not very impressive to them. but I think, you know, they both like to read, and it was very cute because Euphoria was the first book that either of them had read, and I didn't think they would make it past, you know, the 10th page or something, and they were just so cute, and they seemed to like it, and they talk about it with their friends, and it's very, 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 very sweet. I mean, that's been really kind of cute.
That's very sweet. Very nice. Do they come to your readings?
They come to the first one, usually, of each book.
Yeah, okay.
And then they bow out.
Okay, since you're fanning yourself off, I'll ask. You've shown a great willingness to write about very personal things. You wrote a modern love column for the New York Times that was private, heartfelt, and almost tantalizing. I'm curious how you go to those places to write that type of writing that is so personal. I imagine it takes a special kind of courage. Where does that come from?
You know, I don't think it takes very much courage to write personal things. You know, I that's what I like to read. Mm-hmm. I want the most personal things I can find to read. And as a writer, I want to get to the, you know, the very, you know, innermost part, which often involves being personal. Mm-hmm. I think the part that you have to take a kind of a deep breath about is the publishing part. Mm-hmm. And you know, that particular piece, it's a funny transition, because you're writing, and you're not thinking about people reading it. I mean, I can't think about people reading it, or I would never write anything. And then you get finished with it, and then, you know, we're like, oh, well, it's finished. Okay, well, where would it go? Okay, well, maybe I should send it to Dan Jones at Modern Love. And then suddenly Dan Jones is like, yeah, I'll take it. And I'm like, but that's about an old boyfriend of mine, and I don't know, you know, suddenly, I don't know. You have to think all over again. You don't quite realize, you never think it's going to happen, and then when it does happen, you're a little surprised, and then it gets published, and you know, kids read it, or then 2 weeks later you wake up in the middle of the night and you're like, oh my god, I actually, that people have read that, and I didn't mean to, and I don't know, you know, it comes in waves sometimes.
I'm sure it does. The middle of the night makes sense. So I know recently you've lost both your parents.
Yeah.
I'm very sorry about that. Your
Thank
dad
you.
Recently, your mom just a few months ago as well. I'm curious, is that something you're going to write about? Have you written about it? How will that affect your writing, do you think?
Yeah, I think it's really too early to know. My mother died 6 months ago, and my father just a few weeks ago. I've written a lot in my journal about grief and my mom and my dad, and they were divorced since I was 11, and so it wasn't like a, you know, heartbreaking, like he died because he was heartbroken because she died. I don't know if it was a competitive thing, but it's funny. So my first reaction is I have no idea. It feels like I'm still, you know, just trying to get up and tie my shoes in the morning. But on the other hand, I was writing a sort of historical novel. I'd done all of this research. It took place in 1901 in Italy. And, you know, I had a good number of pages. And my mother died extremely suddenly on vacation in the South Pacific. I woke, it was such a shock, and after a couple of weeks after I, you know, finally forced myself to go back to my writing, I didn't even look at that novel that I was writing. I just pushed it aside and started another one. And it was an idea that I'd had before that I knew I wanted to do, but suddenly I wanted to write that novel. And within a couple of days, her mother was dead. And so I guess I'm already writing about someone whose mother has died, and it just, you know, it happened so naturally, you know, that of course her mother would be dead.
And you're still writing that?
I am, yeah.
Okay. So you were able to transition that quickly?
Yeah.
That's interesting, that's fascinating.
But now, you know, and I have moments of like, yearning for the old book, and so I don't think I'm done with it. I don't think it's over for good. I think I'll go back to it.
Do you keep that close by? And I mean literally physically. Do you keep it
in
the proverbial top drawer of your desk?
Yeah, it's actually on top of my desk in a little thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's quite close by.
When you were younger, you did some residencies. I'm interested in your development as a writer from when you were doing the waitressing jobs and that sort of thing. You talked about how you knew you wanted to do this and you were determined to do it. What role did residencies play in your development? And would you encourage them for young writers? And there's so many more of them available today.
Yeah.
I see them advertised all over. A week here, a month there.
Yeah. So, well, I mean, the first, like, real residency I did was going to grad school in creative writing at Syracuse. And so that was a two-year program. And, you know, they offered scholarships and stipends. And so, you know, you got paid to be there and to work and teach and be with other writers. And I, you know, there's always the NYC MFA debate. But, you know, I'm a big fan of the MFA just because... it's good to have that degree if you want to teach, and it just gives you a lot of time to focus on your writing in an unpanicked way. I mean, because the minute you get back in the real world, you know, everything is so expensive, and how can you possibly make a career of this? It was a real shock to me when I first published when I published my second novel. That all they wanted to compare it to was my first novel. And that, I didn't get it. I didn't know that writers are, you know, they're constantly, their main competitor is their former selves. And that was a real shock to me. And so yeah, I already know that I'll get the reviews. Well, you know, it wasn't as good as Euphoria. You know, I have accepted that.
All right.
Yeah, hi.
Hi.
I enjoyed the talk, by the way. I was just wondering, there's a lot of writers who are in one area, like maybe just mystery or whatever. You seem like you're very qualified to write almost anything or any genre. But I don't know.
No, I don't feel like I am. I was just, you know, walking over here with somebody who wrote horror and mystery. I've never tried it. I was so excited in Euphoria. I had a I have a dead body in here, you know? And that was, I have to say, I kind of get it now, because those pages, I remember so well writing them and how easy, like not easy, I couldn't say easy, but just how fun. I was like, oh my God, I have a plot. I have something happening on this page, you know? And you didn't have to write very much because it just kind of, the body was right there. You could just write little things and there was the body and you could kind of feel that it had this power. And so I would like to try something a little bit more, I don't know, macabre, but I haven't yet. So, you know, I'm pretty much still like a, I don't know what they call a literary fiction writer, or, you know, psychological fiction. But thank you. I would love to branch out.
Hi, Lily. I just read Father of the Rain, and it's just a wonderful novel.
Oh, thank you.
The way you captured adolescence. I mean, writing about adolescence and all those memories that I think a lot of people have, and friendships and kids and that side of situation especially dealing with parents. So I really enjoyed that.
Thank you.
I own Euphoria and I haven't read it yet. And did I hear you mention the name Greg Mason just when you were, or did I hear that?
Greg Mason?
Yeah. Okay.
No, Andrew Bankson is the name of the character.
I asked because that my grandfather was an anthropologist named Greg Mason. I thought, oh my God, that would be a real
name. Oh gosh, that's so funny. No, Gregory Bateson is the real life anthropologist, yeah.
But I'm just curious, in Father of the Rain, I mean, when you look at that novel, is there a section in particular that you're most proud of and what you accomplished with the writing and the emotion you captured? Thank you.
Oh, thanks. Thanks for that question. Well, I know that a lot of people have said that the first section, you know, when Daly is 11 years old, you know, kind of hits them at this real kind of visceral level or something, you know, that seems to be the, and so it's hard for me now to separate my feeling from the response that particular section has gotten. I that book was really, really hard to write. Like it would come out, it would come rushing out of me and then it would just dry up. I mean, just, I couldn't write it. And that's when I would actually go and research a little bit more about Margaret Mead and that whole situation in Papua New Guinea, because I couldn't seem to write at certain times with that book. But when I was writing, when it was flowing out of me, it was such a pleasure, and I have kind of pleasurable feelings about all of the parts of it, I have to say, because I wanted to write that book for a long, long time, and I was just really glad to get it out. But I have to say, that first chapter, I wanted to talk about this earlier, you know, talking about autobiographical fiction, and people always ask me, you know, how much of it is autobiographical, and really, I just took the emotions from my childhood and beyond, the emotions of sort of having an alcoholic, very, very committed alcoholic parent and divorced family and broken family and, you know, new steps and all that kind of stuff. And then I took the emotion, but none of these scenes happened in real life. And that first chapter, I feel it is the truest thing I could have written about my childhood, and yet none of it is factually accurate. None of that happened. There's a father who ultimately, at the end of the chapter, very inappropriately strips down and runs around a pool naked in front of a lot of guests and children, actually. And it's horrifying to the mother. They're still married at that moment. And And absolutely none of it happened, and I feel like it just got to the essence of everything, that whole chapter, everything that was going on in my childhood. So I guess maybe that would be one of them.
To me, reading the whole book, I love the way you jump through time, but the truest thing to me seemed the emotion of being the loving daughter of a father who's an alcoholic and dysfunctional and balancing being the good daughter and living your own life.
Thank you so much.
So, question in the back.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Yep. You said in the that your husband is also a writer, and that the two of you negotiate your time relative to your children. Do you think it's harder for a woman to be taken seriously as a writer, as a job, as a place where you also live, than it is for a man?
Yes. I think it's hard for a writer to be taken seriously, especially if you haven't published anything yet. And I think that's a real struggle for writers in general, to kind of take it seriously themselves. And it's so important to do that and to stay committed to it. But yes, I think it's hard. Outward, you know, people, what people think and what people, you know, perceive, but I also think it's hard for women, you know, especially if you're having children and, you know, you have a household and you feel this obligation to clean your house and do the laundry and all that kind of stuff. I think it's, very much a struggle. My husband and I, when we found out that we were pregnant with our first child, I extracted a promise from him. He was so excited, and we were so excited, but I was also like, oh my God, you know, I'm just writing my first novel. What are we gonna do? And he's like, we're gonna do it 50-50. I have made him stick to that, and he regrets those words so much. And so I really have had a 50-50. I mean, every other week I buy the groceries and do the cooking, and every other week he buys the groceries and does the cooking. And you know, it's like down, and I keep it that way. And that has been great. And he has offered me nothing but respect and support, and I am so lucky, really, because I know that is not by any means the case. And I mean, he's been extraordinary. So
great.
I'm here in the back row.
Sorry. Hey, you mentioned a little bit about writing a journal after your parents passed away, and you also mentioned volunteering at the Telling Room and also being on the board there. Can you just talk a little bit about what that means to you and why that's important to you and how writing is important to children today?
Oh, thank you for that question. So I just find that if I'm ever unsettled about anything, if I write it in my journal, if I just write in my journal, like my blood pressure, my heart rate just goes way down. If I'm ever having trouble sleeping, if I get out my book and just write a little bit, I get sleepy. I mean, there's something about just unloading it. And I think it's really important for children to be able, not just to unload, but also to create. And I mean, for me, my journal is not so much a creative act. It really is more of a therapeutic act. But then I have this job that is a creative act, and so I kind of get the best of both worlds. And I feel like at the Telling Room, that's what the kids get too. It's just this wonderful organization that offers creative writing opportunities to children from, you know, 6 to 18, and in all sorts of different ways. And that work is really sacred to me. I mean, I think it's so important, and it's important to all the children that we serve at the Telling Room, but I think it's particularly important to the to the children who come to the Writers and Leaders program, which is, you know, kind of a signature program that we have there. That's high school kids, that, and they're drawn from refugee and immigrant populations in Portland, and they can gather for an entire year. They come every Tuesday, and they gather and write poetry. They have a whole section in narrative, so they tell their story, and they share their stories, and the telling them supports them and gives them a stipend and offers them college essay writing courses and helps them figure out the college application process. And so we have like 100% college acceptance rate in that program. But the most important thing is that they stand up and they tell their stories, which can be so painful and so personal, and they find each other, and they find their own voice, and which gives them so much self-confidence and empowerment, but then they find each other and they know that they're not alone. And these are stories that they are not getting to tell in their high schools or in their communities necessarily. And it's so important, I think, that combination of creative work and personal connection.
Right down here.
Hi.
So
I'm wondering, you were waitressing and wanting to be a writer. How did you make that transition? Did you have a moment where you decided, like, enough is enough? Like, I need to fully commit to being a writer? Did it happen gradually? Or was it just all of a sudden you're like, I need to do this with my life?
That's a great question. I started writing in high school seriously. I took a couple of creative writing classes that thankfully were offered at my high school. And really, I never looked back. I went to college and I studied it, and then I went to grad school and I studied it. And so when I got out of grad school, I moved to Spain. I got a job as a high school English teacher, and I wrote during the summers. But the job was really challenging. It was in a bilingual school, and I couldn't write during the year. When I came back from Spain, that's when I really committed to writing and just taking enough jobs. I moved to California after that, and I got 3 different jobs in a bookstore and as a SAT prep person as a babysitter. I did a lot of nannying. I mean, way past the age that you're supposed to be a nanny. I think I was like babysitting at age 34 as well as waitressing. And I think that's the moment probably when I realized, okay, no more of this messing around, like having a job that's going to take up my writing time or that's going to drain me of my writing energy. I'm just going to focus on writing and then do jobs that don't. Because I think, unfortunately, I loved teaching high school English. I actually went back to it in my mid-30s. I loved that job so much, but it completely drained me of my writing energy. So I think that's when I really did it, and I just started writing a novel. It was really the novel that I just had to see it through, you know? And the novel was, I always say this, it just kind of became I think I moved 11 times, and I had probably 20 different jobs, but I always had the novel. It was like my little home. I was like a little turtle, you know, with my novel, and I would just trot around from place to place and country to country and state to state, and I had my novel. And that's really how I became a writer, I think, because I just, nothing else was as important to me as that novel and finishing it.
Great. Let's see. You want to start right here?
Yep. I can see where you pointed, sorry.
Yeah, no, that's quite all right.
Hi.
You're sitting in a very interesting place right now because you're about to see one of your novels on a big screen. And I'm wondering how that feels.
Oh, that's a good question. Yeah.
Yeah. When I read a book like Euphoria, I'm always seeing the pictures and imagining the book as a movie. but you wrote the book, and I'm just very curious to know how that feels.
You know, I've never, ever actually thought about seeing that as a movie on the screen, because I feel like the chances of it happening are about 1%. So I've never really taken much stock in, I mean, it just seems like there's so many things that have to happen for that to actually take off and to kind of count on that. I mean, I've always been like this. I think it's, you know, goes back to my parents' divorce, if you want to know the truth. I just don't count on much, you know? So I don't look to the future very much. And if I did, though, I think it would really freak me out. I mean, I know I won't like it. I know it will feel weird. It won't look like the way I imagine it looking, just like we all have that experience of just loving a book. I mean, you don't have to... No, I'm not. I mean, I don't even know if I love Euphoria, but of really, you know, knowing a book anyway, and then seeing it on the screen and just being so disappointed, because how can you take a whole novel and, you know, 120 minutes, and you know, you can only get a fraction of it. I often actually like to go to movies first, and because it's like a trailer for the book, you know, and I see, okay, that's what it's, you know, what's going to happen, and then I go and find out what really happened, and I like that much better than the other way around, because it's so disappointing. So,
all right, we got a lot of hands. Okay. A few more minutes. Let's just start right here. Oh, sorry, we'll get you.
This is so exciting to listen to what you have to say, and we just we're a book group, and we were wondering what books you like, or what have you read that do you have time, or just something off, you know, top of your head that you would recommend.
There are so many books I love, but very most recently, I think definitely one of the best books I read all summer was The Days of Abandonment by Elena Ferrante, who wrote the whole Beautiful Child series. But this book is not a series. It's about that thin. It's really short, maybe 120 pages. And it just moves so fast. It's an exercise in concision. And it's about a woman who's husband leaves her on the first page, and she basically has a breakdown. But it's done so well and so beautifully written. I really, really loved that. I'm always saying this, but Old Filth by Jane Gardam is really one of my very favorite books, and was quite an inspiration while I was writing Euphoria. I also love the writer Tessa Hadley, and I read everything she's written. And actually, you know, before over at Local 188, before that, we were talking about books, and I love The Lucky Ones by Rachel Cusk. I wonder if you've read them, have enjoyed the two Knausgård books that I've read, the first and the second. He's the Norwegian writer who basically just writes exactly his life as he sees it, as it happened, and down to every single last detail that you could possibly imagine. And they are, for some reason, I cannot explain why, completely riveting, especially the second one, which is about being a writer. And I just devoured that. I thought it was so fascinating.
Very good.
So I hope someone wrote all those down, because I need that list. We're going to take one more question, but before we do that, I just wanted to let you all know that we've got Longfellow Books in the house. And immediately following this last question and answer, we're going to set up a little pop-up bookshop on the stage. You'll have the opportunity to purchase Lily's books, or if you have one with you, I'm sure she would be more than willing to give you her signature in your book. So we'll line up on this side if that's something you're interested in doing, so that it's easy to get out.
And you can ask me questions then, too.
Yeah.
Okay, so last question. Let me see hands.
Right down here.
You got it.
I'm sorry.
Can we do two?
We'll come over here.
Okay, we'll come over there.
We'll
this one and then that one.
Sorry.
Hi, thanks so much. We're a book group that's been together for 20 years. We're all here tonight.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for coming.
We were wondering when you knew about the button. And it was so interesting that the directors put it in the beginning, because it's just one of the biggest things I've ever read. So how did you find that button and know that was going to happen?
Oh, thank you. So without ruining it, the button is something that appears on, I think, the very last page. will not, I mean, it appears other times, but that's what he's referring to. So I had finished the book, written many, many drafts, handed it in to my writer's group and to my agent, and it was summer, June of 2013, and I was driving on 295 from Yarmouth into Portland. I was just about to turn off on the Franklin arterial exit. I was meeting a friend for lunch. I was late, and suddenly, the novel as it was then ended with him on the boat, or him seeing his mother, and there was no last chapter. And I turned off that exit, or right before I was turning off the exit, as I was turning off the exit, I got out a pad of paper and a pen. I know, not a great driver. And turning off the exit and just frantically taking notes, because I see it. I see it all, the museum, everything. And it's funny because I had gone stupidly. I was such an idiot. I have to say, I was just such an idiot. I had no confidence in this book that I didn't even make a trip to the Natural History Museum in New York City, where they have a Margaret Mead wing. You would think I would go there, but I don't know. I couldn't take it. I don't know. I can't even explain it. I just was writing. I was involved in writing, and I, you know, researched a lot, and I just wasn't going to take time off to take an expensive trip to New York when I was going to write a book that was going to end up in a drawer. Whoops. And so my publisher brought me down for something in May, and so I decided I had a free afternoon, and so I went to the museum, and I looked around, and I took pictures. I had no idea if I was allowed to take pictures or not, but I was like, and one of them was of a skull, and there were cowrie shells, and there was a button. And I saw it, and I thought it was cool. I wondered where it had come from, and then I didn't think about it at all, ever again, until I was on 295, and just, you know, suddenly it all came together. And I don't know, but I feel so lucky that happened, because that's probably my favorite part of the whole book.
Yeah, that's good.
And then of course, I had to go back and, like, make a button, putting buttons on the dress. I mean, I don't think that there were. I mean, I had to, you know, then weave it in. I'm sorry, I'm ruining it for people who haven't read it. Now you're going to be like, wow, that's all devised. So, all right. Thank you for that question.
Last question over here.
Thank you so much. So I just want to say we're so blessed to have you here in Maine. So we're just so lucky. And
I'm lucky.
You talked about this a little bit throughout the night, but could you just talk a little bit more about your research process? I know you said you skipped going to the Natural History Museum, but can you talk a little bit about your research process through this book and or other books? I'm intrigued.
Yeah, thank you. So my research process just involved basically ordering really old books online and for a penny and having them delivered to my house and reading them up on the third floor in my study. And I just, I ordered way more books than I actually ended up reading. But I did, and I certainly, you know, pawed through a lot without reading everything. But I felt like I needed a crash course in anthropology, because I didn't even take an anthropology class in college. So I was, you know, the good news was that I only had to learn anthropology up to 1933, and then I didn't have to know anything else after that. So that wasn't very many decades, actually. And so I had to get a sense of what they were wrestling with, what ideas they would be struggling with at the time. And Margaret Mead was such a great resource for that. I mean, she was so prolific. But of course, you know, I didn't read a lot of what she wrote after 1933, actually. And then I had to find out what it's like to be in the field. I had to find out what it's like to be in Papua New Guinea, because I didn't go there. I had to find out the flora and the fauna. I had some mistakes there in the first and second editions of that book. I will not confess to you what they were, but they were very egregious errors of fauna. And then there were so so many sort of atmospheric things I had to figure out, and I had to find out about the mines, for example, and what kind of mining was happening, what ways in which the Western world was starting to destroy the area and starting to just suck it dry of all of its riches. And so my research process was basically this green notebook, and I would just read books and I would take notes, and sometimes I would see a scene and I would hear dialogue and I would set it up and I'd put a big star. And so I was both taking notes, but also I always had my kind of creative brain on. I love doing that. I mean, I love just, it's a little bit like dreaming, and I sit there with a cup of tea and I'm not writing. The pressure of writing is such a different feeling, but this is just kind of enjoyable. And then, just imagining and imagining things, but no pressure, no, sentences. They don't have to be full sentences and they don't have to be beautiful. And so I just did that for a whole notebook. And so then when I was done with that stage and done, kind of, mostly done, I knew I had spotty things. I had to research World War II, because when I started writing it, it kept on going into the future, and I didn't expect that at first, because I just kept to 1933. And so then I would do spot researching after that. But then I had this whole notebook, and if you've heard me speak before, I've talked about this process before, and I'm sorry if I'm repeating myself, but I got a bunch of notebooks. I thought, okay, real researchers put things on index cards. And so I went out to Rite Aid in Yarmouth and I got all these index cards. And so I just copied everything into an index card. I put a little subject, heading on the one side, and I felt so good. And then I had this huge stack of index cards. And then I had my blank notebook, and I kept on looking from the index card stack to my blank notebook. I'm like, well, this is not how I write a novel. I don't know how I'm gonna do this. And so then somebody said, my friend Sarah Corbett said, you have to get Scrivener, which is a software thing. So I put that on my computer, and I typed up all of my note cards into the computer and, arranged all the topics that way. And then I could do kind of a search. And so when I remembered, she made bread out of crocodile eggs, tell me about that. I just put in crocodile eggs, and then it would all come up. And that was very helpful, but I still had this blank notebook. But by then, I'd written it out three different times, and so it was really in my head. And so then I could, kind of start in. But I did make a timeline, which I usually do for my novels. And so I just, I have it here. I'll just quickly, I know we're running out of time, but this is my timeline for this book. And so I just make a line across the page. I glue two pages together. And then just little ideas, it's not like chapters or anything like that, but just small ideas he gives her his dead brother's glasses, and so then I kind of work toward that scene. And then there'll be another scene that I'll try to work towards. And sometimes they work and sometimes they don't. And sometimes I have to go in a different direction. But I always have a lot more ideas at the beginning than I do at the end. So then it kind of spaces out. And I hope that I'll kind of fill it in. And then I like this timeline because it says at the very end, have some sort of culminating moment. I had no idea how I was going to end the book. So.
Writing advice 101.
Exactly. Yeah.
Beautiful handwriting, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, folks, very much. She's a terrific
thank you so much.